In today's session of Applied Mathematical Finance, I like to continue discussing the implementation of our term structure model, so the classical LIBOR market model. So a model modeling a family of discrete forward rates. We started looking at the implementation. Yeah? So we started, you know, figuring out which parts should be reasonably go into a separate class, you know, abstracted, so hidden behind an interface. And let me find the slide. Yeah, so to shortly review this. Yeah. So this was our model. Yeah. And we decomposed it into some parts, yeah, so like the time discretization here, the Euler scheme, then the parameters that should be provided by a model if we would like to implement many different models, the Brown in motion that encapsulates the random numbers, and all those things here are random variables. And those who have followed the numerical methods lecture, they immediately see that we can reuse a lot of stuff that was introduced there. Actually, everything except for the blue part, the model, is already there. When we did the Euler scheme for the Black-Scholes model, for the Bachelier model, for the Monte Carlo method, the Euler scheme was written in a way that we had a vector. So here it was a vector, but for the Black-Scholes model, the vector had just one element. And the Euler scheme was written to consider multiple factors here, but for the Black-Scholes model, it was just a single factor, dW. And so since we did these two steps, so we were looking a little bit ahead and everything was vector valued and multifactorial, we now have everything at hand. So these classes here, the random variable, the time discretization, the Brownian increment, the Euler scheme, they are already there. And now we can focus on the implementation of the model. So this is now what makes the difference, that these parameters here are a little bit more complicated. So now I like to have a little bit more detailed look into the model. So you see here that in our library, we have many different models here, like the Bachelier model. So as I mentioned, yeah, they all serve the parameters to the Euler scheme. And I also have a Hull-White model, so an interest rate model using the short rate. So I specify mu and lambda for that model and the numerator. And the class which I like to investigate in this session is here the LIBOR market model from a given covariance model. And this here is maybe another aspect, yeah, the covariance model. So you remember that our parameter lambda models the covariance structure. So lambda is sigma I Fik, and Fik is the decomposition of the correlation matrix. Yeah? So lambda models the covariance structure. And since we have so many different versions of the model, so just recall, for example, this slide where we had a log normal one and a normal one. So these two maybe just differ in the choice of the function f. Yeah? But it could also be that here you model this coefficient using a function f where f is the identity, and you just have a different function here in front. So there are different versions, different ways of expressing the coefficient in front of the dw. Of course, we always have the f that also transforms a little bit the process, but I would like to have a great freedom in modeling this coefficient here. So it is that I do not write this class here for a specific version of the lambda. I would like to have the ability to specify different models for lambda. So that is like a model within a model, yeah, a model for the covariance structure. So there is another hierarchy in my object hierarchy. There is a plugin. So we provide here the factor loadings as a plugin to our model. So we like to have the ability to specify different forms of this lambda. So, and this is done by another interface. So there is an interface here called term structure covariance model. And if we have a look at this interface, well, we can have a look. So that is in Monte Carlo interest rate models. And then there's something called here covariance. So somewhere should be this interface. Yeah, so you see it's just an interface that is here consisting of two parts. Yeah, and let's focus on the second part. It just has a single method, the factor loadings. So this is just an interface specifying that a class implementing this interface provides the function lambda. Okay, so another version of this is here the LIBOR covariance model. So this is providing the lambda as a function of indices. So it assumes a certain, already a certain discretization. And then there are different versions, different ways of implementing the lambda. And for example, one interesting thing is that I already mentioned that the Hall-White model, it's a short rate model, it can be written in terms of forward rates with a special structure of the volatility function or the covariance matrix. So maybe we can derive this analytically in a separate session. So this means that there is a specification of this lambda such that the model will generate an interest rate dynamic which corresponds to the Hall-White model. Yeah? So it is also here a Hall-White local volatility model as a plug-in to our model. So we can mimic many different models by just prescribing different covariance structures. So this is linked back to the fact that our discretized forward rate model, so our LIBOR market model, our model for the discretized interest rate curve is just a discretization of the Heath-Jerome-Morton framework. And all those models that use these ETO processes are just versions of the Heath-Jerome-Morton framework. And then there are some models that use some low parameter exponential forms, so some low parameter forms to reduce the number of parameters. I will come to this. Or for example, there's also a stochastic volatility model where lambda has its own stochastic driver. Yeah? So you can create a stochastic volatility model. Okay, so that's another aspect that I would like to actually make this a plugin, so make this be represented by its own interface, which allows me to construct many different models just by plugging in, so just by injecting. Yeah, so we have again some kind of dependency injection. So the model depends on how lambda is specified, and we inject the specification of lambda by passing a class implementing this interface. Okay, and we have a lot of flexibility, so we have many different models. So a last step in my discussion of different classes is now that I would like to use the results or the simulated forward rates and the numeraires in the valuation. So here in the slide is just the summary of what I just said. Yeah, so we provide these plugins, and there's also some code that performs a calibration of the covariance, but calibration will be discussed a bit later. So a last step is that I would like to use the result of my simulation. So the result of the simulation is the result of the Euler scheme. I would like to use this in evaluation. And if you go back to the Euler scheme, so somewhere we have the Euler scheme. So the model is an input to the process, and the process is the Euler scheme. So the Euler scheme should be lying around here. Then if you take a look what the Euler scheme does, so the Euler scheme uses some model to create a stochastic process. And this stochastic process has a time index and a component index. So this here is actually the Li of Tj. Yeah? So this here is the I, so which forward rate, and this here is the J. And of course, the Euler scheme is used for many different models. So it's actually just some Xi of Tj, and we do not know what X is. So going back to the slides, this is our Euler scheme that doesn't know which kind of model it is simulating. And this Euler scheme generates some vector X using the time discretization and the retransformation to the space of the variables which we like to generate, yeah, so from the state space to the original space. And in our special version, the X has become the Li of Tj. So when I like to use now the result of the Euler scheme, I would like to have some interface and then some classes implementing this interface that actually make the assignment, okay, the forward rate for the period from T4 to T5 is actually the index 4 in this vector simulated by the Euler scheme. So it is X4. So I have to make this mapping. And this mapping is now done with a very small class that is just wrapping the Euler scheme and providing a certain function. So this is here. So I specify an implementation that is, or I specify an interface that is called here Term Structure Monte Carlo Simulation Model. So quite long name, but everything is in there. And if we take a look at this guy, so where is that? So it is in Monte Carlo interest rates. So term structure, Monte Carlo simulation model. Yeah, you see that this guy is, it's an interface, and it's just saying that, okay, there should be a method, yeah, that has the name get forward rate. And it gives me the forward rate for a given time, little t, for a period from S to T, yeah, period start to period end. And you already see that this is not with an index. So stuff that implements this should also make some interpolation. And this is then the stuff which we can use when we value a financial product. So now I can value a financial product using the Monte Carlo method just by asking, okay, model, please give me the forward rate for the given period, and then I can calculate all the stuff. So of course, it also provides the numeraire. So there are these two things here, the numerator and the forward rate, and there are just some default implementation for versions that uses a date where the date is then converted to a floating point number mapping to the date, and the same here. So that's a very small interface. Yeah, so for historic reason, there's also the synonym LIBOR, and that's it. Yeah, so that, then it's done. Okay, so this is just a wrapper. Renaming the get process into get forward rate and making the right assignment. And in case that these guys do not lie on the time discretization, it also performs the interpolation. Yeah? So an implementation of this interface should also perform the implementation. And now we are done. Yeah. So so the process, so the Euler scheme here provides these two guys here, yeah, or provides this these the Euler scheme provides the underlying rates. The model provides the numerator. So we would like to have the both things under a single interface. Yeah. So class is implementing now this interface. They delegate either to the model or to the Euler scheme. So can we see this? So if we look here at the class is implementing this. So you see that there is some delegation here either to the model or to the process. So for example, for the forward rate, I ask the model, yeah, because the model should perform the implementation. Yeah. And for the numerator, I also ask the model. Yeah, for the numerator, and the model will then get here the process, so the Euler scheme, and ask for the simulated objects, perform the interpolation if necessary, yeah, or perform the calculation of the numerator. So these are just delegations, and then some collection of handy methods. Okay. So now I should be, I believe, through here. Yeah, and I like to discuss a little bit the implementation of this model. Okay, so now I like to have a more detailed look here into this guy, the guy providing us with the drift, the factor loadings, this transformation, and the numerator. Yeah? So for our term structure model. So I would like to use that one. So here are different interest rate models, like the Hull-White model. And there is this guy, which we would like to have a look at. So unfortunately, this class has become quite big over time, and this is actually a sign that it's not so good. We should actually maybe decompose it into different components. And I can also show you a nice suggestion what you could do to make this a bit nicer. Yeah. So a lot of stuff has been added over time. For example, different ways of interpolating rates. Yeah, so it's also used for research sometimes. But you see that they are just the basic methods here. So there is give me the drift. So give me the mu. So this is the function used by the Euler scheme. Yeah, this is the model used by the Euler scheme. Give me the mu. Then there is give me the lambda. Give me the factor loadings. And there is give me the numerator. Okay, so, and let's have a look at these three parts. So the drift. So you see that the drift here gets several arguments. So it gets the time index. So this is mu at tj. It also gets here from the Euler scheme passed in the current realization at the time index. So if we go back to the slides, so now where is that? Maybe I didn't stress this, but when I wrote down the Euler scheme here in these transformed coordinates, the mu gets the L as an argument. So the mu gets the L, not the Y. Yeah. So you could pass any of the two because you know that this is the transformation from Y to L, but the mu gets the L, the forward, the vector of forward rates. Yeah. So not Li, so the whole vector as an argument. So for the LIBOR market model or for the our term structure model, I know that this drift here is a function, a sum over many of these Li's. So I can access this because I get it as an argument. And this is also the case here in this implementation. So we get the time index, the tj, for which we like to calculate the drift, and we get the L, the full vector. And since when we discussed the efficient implementation of the drift, we observed that sometimes it's possible to reuse parts. This function here is specified, so this method is specified to return the full drift vector. So this guy returns mu, where the elements of the vectors are the mu I. So this generates the full vector for the Euler scheme. So here on the slide, it will generate the vector of the mu i's, yeah, so that we can actually drop the argument I here and view this as a vector notation. Okay, so we are at a certain time index. So for this time index, I have to find the time. This is the time index little t. So it is the time index belonging to the Euler scheme, to the process. So I ask the Euler scheme, okay, so what is the corresponding time? Then I go to the model. So this is now the model, and ask, what is the corresponding index on the interest rate curve discretization? So on the tenor. Yeah? So this here is now the mapping from t, from j to little t. Yeah. So now I have from j to little t. And this here is the mapping from little t to say, now it's I, where ti. So now there is here a plus one, yeah. So there is it's the index after that, yeah. So say ti is larger than t, yeah. So actually this here is the mt plus one, yeah. So this here is the mt, yeah. This here is the little t. This here is the mt. This here is the mt plus one. Okay, so you know that we have to sum, yeah, in the drift from mt plus one to the end, yeah, or from mt plus one to the current rate. Okay, so that's the conversion of the time, and you see that we have two different time discretizations involved. Yeah? So the stochastic process, the Euler scheme knows about the discretization of the little t, and the model knows about the discretization of the interest rate curve. Then I need to calculate a sum. Yeah? So I'm initializing here all the drifts to zero. And the drift is then given by an update rule. So let's recall how the drift was specified. So we had a session on the efficient implementation of the drift. So this is the original version of the drift. So you see it's a sum from MT. So actually there is a smaller here. Yeah. So including it would be MT plus one to I. Yeah. And then that it was here the sigma I, sigma L, the correlation rho I L. Multiplied with this factor here. But in this session here, efficient implementation of the drift, we derived that if we write the model in terms of these factor loadings lambda, then we can rewrite this sum here much nicer, because this was here for every I. So it was a vector of n drifts. And it included a sum, yeah, which was approximately order n. So it was order n squared. And we can make this faster if the number of factors m is much, much smaller. So we went through these derivations and found that the drift can be written, rewritten as this sum. So it is lambda ik multiplied with alpha ik, only a sum over m. So you see it's order n times m. But alpha ik are, well, a sum of their own. But if you take a closer look, you see that they are just updated, yeah, from the previous I to the next I. This was for the spot measure. For the terminal measure, it was actually going backward, yeah, updated from the later one. You update the earlier one. So this was for the terminal measure. It was because the sum was running in the different direction. And in summary, we found this nice implementation. Yeah? So I can calculate the drift as a very nice sum, just lambda ik, so the factor loading of the rate for which I calculate the drift, multiplied with alpha k, where alpha k is updated using this update rule. Yeah, so there is here this special term, okay, in this update rule. And for the spot measure, we run, we run forward over all I, and for the terminal measure, we run backward over all I. Yeah, so this changes this update, and we had here the same sum. So let's see if this is now my implementation. Okay. So the alpha I k's are updated in every loop. So I need some vector. Yeah. So this is called here covariance factor sum. Yeah. So if we go back here on the slide, you don't see there's an alpha ik, yeah, because I iterate over, there is no alpha ik, I iterate over I. I just need to remember the alpha k. So alpha k is a vector of size m. Yeah. Alpha k for k from 1 to m. And in the code, I call this covariance factor sums. I believe I call it covariance factor sums. Let's call covariance factor sums. Okay. So these are the alpha case. Okay, and I initialize these guys to zero. Okay, so there's these guys are initialized to zero. This is what I do here. And the same for the terminal measure. Yeah, so the beta k is the same. And I also call them covariance factor sums in the code. Okay. So after that, the two algorithms are a little bit different. So if I'm in spot measure or if I'm in terminal measure, they are slightly different because one guy is going forward. So you see, I run over all I with a plus plus, and one guy is going backward. I run over all I with a minus minus. So let's have a look at this guy here. So now covariance factor sums is initialized to zero. And now let's look what we are doing here. So here I'm running forward. Over all I. So I start at MT plus one. So I calculated MT plus one above and I run until the end of my forward rate discretization. So this is this on the slide an N minus one? I don't remember. Yeah, so an N minus one, I believe. Okay, so smaller the number of components of this vector. So then I check for the period length. The period length is from the forward rate from the LIBOR period discretization. So this here is the delta I. And I can ask the time discretization to give me Ti plus one minus Ti. Then I need the forward rate. And I already mentioned the Euler scheme passes me. So the Euler scheme is so nice to pass me the current state of the simulation step. So I can ask just give me the Li. So this here is the Li, the current Li. So at the current time. Yeah, so everything is at the current time. So of t. Then you see that here on where's that? Yeah. Then you see we very often need this term here. So delta I divided by one plus delta I L I. So actually this is just the time step, yeah. But it is this here is coming from the discretization of the curve. And actually this term pops in when you transform the measure from say PTI plus one to PTI. Yeah, so for that reason, I call it one step measure transform, but maybe that's not a good name. Yeah, so this guy here is, this guy here, is just the calculation of delta I, the period length, divided by one plus L I delta I. Yeah, so this function here, discount, is just the same with multiplied with one plus this times this. So this guy is just the delta I divided by one plus delta I L I. Okay, so because this guy appears in the calculation of the drift. And you know that in the special version of the model where the model is written in log normal form. So when the model is written in log normal form, then there's actually an Li on top. Yeah, so then it is Li delta I divided by one plus delta I Li. Okay, so in case my state space is the log normal one, I multiplied this. So you see that this class here is a little bit fat. It can make different measures and it can make different versions. Namely, it can make the normal one and the log normal one. Yeah? So the normal one is the default one. And here I check if I'm log normal. So this is just a little bit preparation. So we have defined the quantities which we need. And now comes this sum over all k. Yeah. So this sum over all k. Here. And the update of the alpha case. So I sum over all k. And I have to do this for all k. So actually, I can do these two steps here, the sum and the for all k in a single loop. Yeah. Because I need here the alpha k and the sum. But this here means before you do this, update it. And here it's vice versa. You need the beta k in the sum. And after you have used the beta k in the sum, updated. So you can write this here and the sum in a single loop. And it's just the order that is different. First update, then use the new value in the sum. Or here, use the value in the summation and then update. Let's see if this is in the code. So you see, I have here a single loop over all k. So this here is for all k. For k from 1 to m. Okay. And you see, I have here the update of the alpha k, and then I perform the sum. Yeah. New value is previous value plus the element of the sum, the term in the sum, the summand. And here for the terminal measure, it's just the other way around. It is for all k, first update the sum, so perform the summation, then update the beta k. Okay, so you see the difference is just here the order of the two expressions. So this part here is update the alpha k. So the alpha k is the new alpha k is the old alpha k. So plus, yeah, so add our expression here for the delta I divided by 1 plus delta I li. So plus delta I divided by 1 plus delta I li multiplied with the factor loading. So the factor loading here at the corresponding factor. So the lambda ik. The lambda I. Okay, so the factor loading, where do I get the factor loading? Here I ask for the factor loading. So here I ask the factor loading, please give me the factor loading for this component I, yeah, and I get a full vector. You see here, I get all lambda I k's for all k's. Yeah, so I get the lambda I. So this guy here is the lambda. This guy here is the lambda I, the full vector lambda I. So then, if I have updated the alpha, then I can update the drift. So the drift is updated. The new mu I is the mu I plus the alpha k times lambda I k. So let's check if this is what was on the slide. Yeah, so this is the summation. Yeah, the new mu I is the previous mu I plus lambda I k alpha k. And the update is alpha k plus this guy here. So this delta I divided by 1 plus delta I li multiplied with the factor. So you see that this implementation is quite short. Yeah, it's quite short. So that's all we have to do for the drift. If you remove these special cases here, yeah, it's actually just a few lines. Yeah, so it's actually one loop here, two lines here. Yeah, a little bit preparation. Yeah, so it's 4 or 5 lines to implement this drift in a very efficient, very short form. And for the terminal measure, it's just the small modification that here the inside the order of the update rule is reversed and the loop runs in reverse order. Okay, so this is the calculation of the drift. The calculation of the drift here is done for two different measures, spot measure and terminal measure. And it's also done for two different versions of the model in normal form, so where I assume that the model is written as lambda I times dw, yeah, times dw. So this is in vector notation. So the sum lambda I k dw k. So this is the normal form, or the log normal form where it is lambda I l I dw. Yeah, or since I have a scalar product, I should say Li, lambda I multiplied with dw. So if there is an Li in front of the dw or not. So this guy can do both versions. If I'm in log normal one, I simulate the logarithm of the forward rates. So that was the version where we are using the Euler scheme on the log coordinates, then the drift has to have an adjustment. And this small adjustment is just here below the drift adjustment for the case where I use log coordinates. And this is the -1/2 sigma squared here. Yeah? So this is the -1/2 sigma I squared. Well, sigma I squared is the norm of the lambda I, but the covariance model which we use can calculate this norm. Yeah, so this is provided by this covariance model. Yeah, speaking about the covariance model, here I have a method get factor loading. Yeah, so that's the next part of what this class here is providing. So the class provides the drift and it provides the get factor loading. So let's have a look at the get factor loading. So the get factor loading is just here below the calculation of the drift. And you see that this get factor loading has a very small implementation. So this provides the lambda I of tj. Yeah, so this guy here is the I, this guy is the j. And it provides this by delegating the calculation of the lambda I to a different class. So this is what I meant with plug-in. So I like to use later this model with different versions, how we model the lambda I, so model within the model. So there is this covariance model here that takes care of providing the factor loadings. So this is delegation, yeah, delegating to a covariance model. And you pass this covariance model to this class here in the constructor. So if you take a look here where this is, there is here the covariance model. This here is just an interface. So there is a little I here. Interface for covariance model providing a vector of possibly stochastic factor loadings. Yeah. So the factor loading, if you go back, is a random variable. Yeah? So I write everything very general. Every object is a random variable. So the factor loading can be stochastic. So you can simulate a log normal model in normal state space by providing sigma I li. So then sigma I li is a random variable. So and many different cases where you have a true stochastic volatility model, yeah, can be realized, yeah, because this is a vector of random variables. So I provide this guy here by delegating to this covariance model, and the covariance model is just when you construct this object, there is a big constructor here, it's just passed to this class. So we can later construct different versions of this by passing different covariance models. So we pass the discretization of the interest rate curve. This here is to specify the initial value of the model, and the drift is known, yeah, by which measure we use, and we can pass this covariance model. So next thing provided here by this class, by this big class, is the numerator. And that was another aspect I was mentioning. The guy that calculates the drift should also calculate the numerator. So there is here a numerator, get numerator. And yeah, unfortunately, this class is a little bit, has become a little bit bigger over time, because it also performs several interpolations of the numerator. Recall that the numerator in the original version is only known at the tenor discretizations, capital TI, yeah, because we haven't specified the short period bond. But here it performs some interpolations. And for that reason, yeah, the code is a little bit bigger here. I will just ignore this part with the interpolation. So the first thing that you see about the numerator here is that there is some kind of adjustment. So this class here allows to adjust the numerator, for example, with a default probability. So there can be a default probability. I also discussed this not in the current session. Yeah, so let's ignore this adjustment here and just look at how we calculate the numerator, the unadjusted numerator. So the classic numerator that I have derived or defined on the slides. Okay, so I will have a look here at this method, calculate the unadjusted numerator. So just to explain this, this here is some adjustment. To model default probabilities. Because they can be associated in some sense with the numerator, or funding costs. so this is here for. So this is an additional extension of the model. And I just want to look at this part of the code that calculates the unadjusted numerator. So since the numerator is needed sometimes multiple times, I have here implemented some kind of cache. So first I check, is the numerator inside this cache? So there is here a cache. So the cache is here just some storage where I can store the numerator. I check if is this numerator already in this cache? Yeah. If not, I will get a null and I calculate the numerator here. And then I put the numerator into this cache. Yeah, so put the calculated numerator into the cache. And then I return the calculated numerator. So, okay, that's these two things on the top and on the bottom, or just some caching in case you ask for the same domain again and again. He can just pull it out of this storage. And the calculation of the numerea is here in between. And you see, like for the drift, the numerea defines which measure we are. So actually the numerea is here the terminal or the spot numerea. I have two different parts calculating the numerea for the simulation under the terminal measure, or calculating the terminal bond, or simulation under the spot measure, or calculating the rolling accrual account. And you see that the difference of the two is similar. So one is a summation going forward. One is a summation going forward, and the other one is summation going backward. So funny, you don't see any summation here. Yeah. So this summation is implemented by just calling the method again with the previous time index. So it is numerea at the current time is the numerea at the previous time multiplied with some additional factor. So this is the accrual, and the accrual is done here by going calling the method again with an earlier point in time. So which could then go into the cache because we have already calculated this. So this is a slight improvement if you are calling, for example, the numerea at times ti, ti plus one, ti plus three, then you don't have to perform this again and again. You just look in your cache, okay, I already have calculated the numerea at ti, so for ti plus one, I just take this and multiply it. So there is some kind of recursive definition here. For the terminal measure, I cannot do this because the sum is summing over the forward rates. So here, let's annotate this a little bit. This here is the sum over the forward rate, say Li. And this forward rate is observed, or let's call it Lj, at the time index Ti, where Ti is actually here this index. So this is Di, and I would like to calculate n of Ti here. So this is the object n of Ti, which I'm calculating. And you see that for the terminal measure, you sum over all j and pick the forward rate observed at ti. So the numerea at the next time point uses a different vector of these forward rates. Yeah, while here for the numerea in spot measure, it's just an update, the previous one, which was Lj at Tj, multiplied with the next one, which uses Lj plus one, observed at Tj plus one. Yeah. So maybe I just write you down the two numereas. So in terminal measure, the numerea at Ti is the sum, the product. Sorry, it's the product. I said sum, yeah, but it's of course the product. J from, so how does it go from I to N minus one? One plus Lj observed in Ti, delta J to the power of minus one. It's the bond that matures at the end, and I divide by all the rates. And for the spot measure, the numerea, the NTI is the product. Well, I accrue from the beginning, J from zero, to the current point. I accrue one plus Li, Lj of Tj. Yeah, so it's always the one uh, at the fixing time of the current rate. So here I can use this somewhat little bit more efficient recursive update of the numeria. Yeah, so, and that's the numeria. And you see that here I have a power of minus one. So this power of minus one corresponds to dividing by this. So here this corresponds to the word discount. Yeah. The numeria is the new numeria is the previous numeria divided by this expression, yeah, or in this updot rule. And here I have, say, to the power of plus one. So maybe I can here draw a little one. Yeah, so this is just a plus one. So this corresponds here to the word accrue. Yeah, so we accrue. We multiply. Yeah? So if you go into the implementation, so where is this unadjusted? This here is my implementation. Then if you move here to the words discount, yeah. So these are operations on random variables. So again, you see that my random variable provides very useful operations, and you see that this discount is just x divided by one plus the rate times period length, and this accrue here is just x multiplied with one plus rate period length. I already mentioned that this class here is a little bit big, yeah. So you see, it already has here 1,000 lines. So if you go to the end, it has even more, yeah, 1,700 lines. So it does a lot of stuff, more stuff has been added over time. So it can do two different measures. It can do two different state spaces, and it can do interpolation. And that's an indicator, if a class is becoming that fat, that maybe you should consider cutting it into smaller pieces. So question, what would be a nice redesign of this class? So if you see something like this here for where I calculate the drift, yeah, then this is already a good indication what you could change in the design. Because you see that I have this if statement here. If I'm under spot measure, then do it like this. If I'm under terminal measure, then do it like that. And I have this if statement in a similar way at a different place, namely here in our numeria. In our numeria, if I'm under terminal measure, calculate the numeria like this. If I'm under spot measure, calculate the numeria like this. So you have two different if statements that have to be consistent at two different places. And a nice way of redesigning this is like we did for the covariance model. We provide the calculation of the drift and the numeria as a specific interface. Let's call this interface measure. Yeah? We could call it the measure because the drift and the numeria under a certain measure. Yeah? And then we have two different implementations for this interface, the implementation terminal measure and the implementation spot measure. Then this code here just calls this interface, okay, please give me the drift for this corresponding measure, or please give me the numeria for the corresponding measure. So this redesign will ensure that the two if statements are always consistent, because in this class, the two if statements for the drift and the numeria, they are at very different locations. So it could be that a programmer says, okay, here I have to change something, but he forgot to check that there is another if statement at a different place. If you collect everything in a single class, he sees, okay, this is the class that provides drift and numerair, and if I change the drift, I also have to change the numerair. So that would be a redesign, and this redesign makes the class a lot smaller, because this bunch of code here will be replaced just by a single call for the numerair, and the same for the drift. Yeah. So that's just a suggestion. Yeah. I just wanted to show you a little bit what you can do, and what are signs, how you could redesign this. Well, this programming is a little bit like an art. Yeah. So there is no right or wrong. Yeah. So some stuff is maybe nicer. Yeah. And it's also maybe a matter of taste. Yeah, but that's what I would do maybe next to clean up this class. And then, for example, also the interpolations or adjustment could be offloaded to a different class. So I can conclude the session with the last remark on how now this simulation, the simulated forward rates, is used in a financial product. So that's just my last slide here for today. So for product valuation, I now write the code that performs the Monte Carlo valuation of a financial product just in terms of a single interface. Namely, for example, the interface that I showed you already that has this method get forward rate and get numerair. Okay, so our model, together with the Euler scheme and together with some small wrapper, generates now the else and the ands. And now I forget about what model was used, and I just write the product valuation in terms of these quantities, which means that I later can evaluate financial products using all those different models, the Hull-White model, you know, the LIBOR market model, a log normal one, a normal one, or stochastic volatility, or whatever. Let's take a look at an example. So what I mentioned was that I have this interface which wraps the result of my simulation into two different methods, get the forward rate and get the numerair. And now I write the valuation of a financial product only in terms of these two, which allows me that I can inject different models to perform the valuation. So there is a bunch of financial products here in products, and there are also some components of financial products like a period or an index, a cash flow, an option, yeah, where you can like building blocks, yeah, so small Lego blocks, where you can build up your financial products, yeah. And maybe that's a nice project which we can do later. And there are a few standard products like a caplet or a swap. Yeah. A swap is just the difference of two swap legs. So there's the swap leg, yeah. There is a swaption, a Bermudan swaption, yeah. Different versions of the Bermudan swaptions. Maybe I take a simple swap here. Yeah. So there's an idealized swap that has just some fixing dates, the capital TI, some payment dates, usually the TI plus one of the corresponding periods, some swap rates, the SI, yeah. Some notional, yeah, an amount multiplied with the period, and then some Boolean that says, is it L minus S or is it S minus L? Yeah. So that's a very simple version of the swap. And you see that this is the constructor just setting the values. And apart from the constructor, there's just this little part of code here. So from here to here, and that's it. Yeah. So there's a little bit more getters to get the values. Yeah. Get start time, get fixing dates, and so on. But the essential code is just this part here. So the swap is more or less just a function that calculates the value of the financial product under a given model. And you see the model I'm assuming here is of this interface. Yeah. So I ask the model, give me the forward rate, give me the numerator. I need the numerator at two different times. I need the numerator at the payment time, and I need the numerator at evaluation time, because you know, universal pricing theorem, value is numerator at valuation time multiplied with expectation payment divided by numerator at payment time. And from the forward rate, I calculate the payoff in this period. The payoff in this period is L minus S times period length multiplied with the notional. If it is not L minus S, instead it is S minus L, I multiply with minus one. I divide by the numerator at the payment time, and I take the sum over all those periods. You see that my Euler scheme, and so my model, also provides the ability to do some weighted Monte Carlo. So the Monte Carlo weights can be different from one. So there is still here this get Monte Carlo weights. But yeah, you can maybe ignore this now. So, and you see that this is just the evaluation. You see, I return a random variable. I don't return the expectation of the random variable. The reason is that maybe someone likes to use the pathwise values. But if you now take the expectation, so just dot get average of this object, which I'm returning here, this is the value of the swap. Okay, so the only aspect is that I'm now defining all valuations in terms of this interface.